First of all, I'd like to thank the organizer for giving me chance to speak in this conference. So today I'll be telling you about dense suspensions, which are basically liquid-like materials, which have very interesting force response. So in this picture, this white-colored substance is a dense suspension. And under a tensile load, you can see that it formed this first-term shape, which you don't see in usual liquids like water and oil. Okay. So in general, I am interested in studying adaptive materials. So adaptive materials are materials whose mechanical properties are not fixed, but that depends on external cues. So depending on external conditions, the mechanical properties can be changed. And these changes are can be very rapid, reversible, and controllable. So such materials, they have ability to keep pace with the changing environment. So what is a dense suspension? It is a very simple system. It is a mixture of liquid like water and oil, and you add some colloidal or granular particles. So one condition is, like, you have to add this particle at very high density, like almost 50% liquid and 50% solid. The interesting point is, although we know everything about the flow properties or force response of this liquid and all about the grains, it is very difficult to predict the mechanical response of this mixture. And apparently we need new theories and new insights to understand the proper force response of dense suspension. So why these materials are very striking, I'll give you an example. This video was taken by a grad student in Chicago, where I was a postdoc. So you can see that this white-colored substance, this is a mixture of cornstarch particles in water, again, at very high volume fraction. It is almost 50% cornstarch particle, 50% liquid. And cornstarch particles are like amorphous particles. Roughly, average size is around 15 micron in diameter. So you see that under small perturbations, small or slow perturbations, this is pretty liquid-like. You can run your finger through this suspension very easily. But if you heat it really hard, instead of splashing out, you can see that it really behaves like a solid and you can hurt your hand. And you can also, on a pool of cornstarch particle, you can also run across, like you can actually walk on a run on a liquid. Okay, so this substance, it turns into a transient solid under impact, and it was termed as a impact activated solidification. And this phenomena was explained by my advisor and the grad student in 2012. So what they found is, so this yellow colored substance, this is a suppose cornstarch suspension kept in a container. And if you have a metal rod coming down at a velocity V, what they found is there is a growing solid-like region underneath which propagates, which expands very rapidly and very quickly reaches the solid boundary of the container. And once that happens, since this point of impact is connected to this solid boundary by a solid-like material, it is really difficult to compress it further. So if you study the force response on this rod, what they have shown here as a function of the displacement. So initially in this growth phase, the force on this rod is increases very slowly. But once this solid region extends to the container boundary, then force shoots up by orders of magnitude. Okay. And but the question was, what is the response under non-compressive deformation? Because the idea they had at that time is, like, under impact, since you have a lot of solid particles, you are pushing the particles onto each other to form this solid-like region that grows very rapidly. But instead, suppose instead of pushing it down, if I lift the rod upward, it was not clear what will be the response. Maybe it will break off very weakly. So when I joined Chicago as a postdoc, I started working on that problem. So this is, again, very simple system, again, a dense suspension of cornstarch particle. And again, the volume fraction is very high, like I mentioned. We have a plate on the surface, And this plate is connected to a force transducer, so you can control the velocity and also measure the force on the plate. Now what we are going to do, we want to lift this plate up at constant velocity and study the force response and see what happens. We have also imaged what happens by a fast camera. So this is typical image of an experiment. You can see that you have a circular plate, and this is the rod connected to the force transducer, and this is the top surface of this suspension. Okay. So if I pull this plate up at a sufficiently high velocity, you can see that instead of quickly detaching, it takes out this frustum shape, solid-like frustum shaped region, and it breaks off. So this structure you usually don't see in a liquid. So because initially when I was doing this experiment, I thought that anyway this system is very dense, so maybe this is a common thing for any dense liquid. So then I took a Newtonian liquid, but the viscosity is 10,000 times more than the water. It's almost even more viscous than honey. And if I keep all the parameters same, you can see the difference. So actually, it goes up and it forms this nice neck, and then this fluid flows down. So this is typical. This typical behavior you see if you take out a spoon out of a jar of honey, basically. You see exactly this kind of behavior. So something different is going on for dense suspension, even if you pull onto it. And also, like I mentioned, we measured force on the plate. And you see for low cooling velocities, like for 0.5 millimeter per second or less than 1 or 2 millimeter per second, your force response is extremely weak. You get this blue curve. But if you go slightly higher velocity, you see that there is a slowly growing region, and then force shoots up, and this is several orders of magnitude higher than what the force you typically get. And for very highly viscous liquid, your force response typically lies in these regions. So dense suspension, it has a very high, very strong force response. So these are two trials of the system, basically. So one thing you can note is like they are pretty much similar, but only difference is the peak force sometimes. So actually peak force that I will not probably have time to discuss. So what peak force you will get, that depends on the adhesion strength between the suspension and the plate. And that is kind of random. We couldn't control that. But otherwise, the dynamics is very, very similar. Yes. Yeah. So, Kronstadt's particle, they have like a density of 1.6. Although I'm telling all the time that it is water, but we add some salt, cesium chloride with water to match the density with the particle so that, like, if you make the solution, it stays stable for a long time. So you have to increase the density of the solution to around 1.6. Okay. Okay. So actually, these force, it is much higher than prediction of capillary interaction or other hydrodynamic theories. So they predict a peak force. If you calculate absolute maximum from these predictions, it lies around this region. We see like 1.5 orders of magnitude stronger response. And coupled with this frustum shape that we don't see in normal liquid, we see that we thought that indeed it is there is a formation of solid-like material even under pooling, not only impact. Okay? So now, how can a dense suspension turns into a solid? So there is a mechanism called jamming transition. This was famous Liu-Nagel phase diagram in the parameter 2D version of that, in the parameter plane of stress and volume fraction. Suppose I have a dense suspension. I have a liquid and I put only few particles, not very high density. So the overall response of the system will be pretty much like liquid only. But if you increase the volume fraction along this axis, you cross a point pi j, called the jamming point, Then if you add more particle, the system behaves more like a solid and develops a yield stress. And for frictionless spheres, this density is typically around 0.64, this packing fraction. But the problem was, in our case, we are not adding extra particle, right? Everything is happening under force. And also, our pooling speeds or deformation speeds, they are well below the sound propagation speed in this material. So we are not compressing the system locally also. So this, although this is a very well-established theory of how a material can go from a liquid-like to solid-like state, this is not likely the mechanism in our case. Instead, there was a modified version of this phase diagram. Again, like if you ignore this part, this is basically you have a jammed region and unjammed region beyond the packing fraction phi j. But if you focus on this green region, what it tells is that if you have sufficiently high density of particle, but below, well below phi j, that means like you are not jammed as such. But what you can do now, you can increase stress on the system, like you can go along the vertical axis. And then if the particle have friction, then they can form these force chains. This is a geometric jamming, like without changing any packing fraction, you can basically give rise to this contact network which are stabilized by friction, and that can give rise to a solid like yield stress. Although this is shear is a volume preserving deformation. And indeed, for dry granular system using photoelastic bead, it has been shown that you have these force chains. These bright particles are like these chain-like structures are stress-bearing chains, basically. So what we did, we measured the flow field inside the suspension. You cannot see inside optically because it's a opaque suspension by X-ray and ultrasound imaging. You can get the velocity profile out and you can measure the strain rate tensor. What you see that you have a, like as you pull onto this, you have a correlated region. Correlated region means it is translating like a rigid body. You get this correlated region, and if you estimate the strain rate tensor, you can see that around this region, you have a strong shear, like this is the scale bar basically. These bright regions correspond to strong shear. There are localized shear around this solid-like region, correlated region. That means the boundary shear is maintaining this solid-like region. So it looks like the shear jamming is a likely mechanism. And surely enough, we did a direct experiment actually. So you take this suspension instead of extension or compression, you apply a pure shear. So you have this cylindrical container and you put a cylinder which can rotate. And I'll play the movie. You can see that as the inner cylinder rotates, it can support the steel ball. That means under shear, it is turning into a solid. But as soon as the shearing stops, the ball sinks. And although there is no direct evidence experimentally of these force chains, there are some simulation prediction that under shear you can actually jam the suspension of frictional particles. Okay. So these are the conclusion. So the non-compressive deformations are also very similar. They show similar response as impact because the basic mechanism is shear. So it doesn't depend on which you are impacting onto the surface or you are applying shear or compression. And one non-trivial thing that I didn't mention is like, as you pull it up, the growth of this correlated region is down so that this jamming front travels opposite to the forcing direction and jamming is purely shear induced. So one question is like, which is a good way to study this suspension because they are in between liquid and solid. They're kind of 50-50 mixture, but we have to remember that there is this jamming point. So actually these suspensions are more towards solid side, I would say. So compared to hydrodynamic theories, probably our approach to study this suspension should be starting from the surface properties and tuning the frictional interaction between the particles. And so this is the acknowledgement. This was my postdoc work I carried out in Chicago. Funding and thanks for that. So in dense suspension, in the shear jammed regime, so the latest numerical prediction, what they show is like there is a breakdown from breakdown of lubrication, and they come into direct contact. People previously used to model it in a pure hydrodynamic manner or pure frictional manner, but apparently the most likely mechanism is like you have lubricated contact under small perturbation, but that because of surface roughness, that lubrication is broken under high force, and then they come into direct contact, and then it freezes the system. So you have to consider both hydrodynamic to contact dominated.
Yeah. So in your diagrams, you know, I mean, you have hard spheres that are jamming, right? Mm. But you don't have hard spheres that are jamming because you have irregular disks.
Yes.
So that is presumably also very important to the jamming of these particles, because as you mentioned, the interparticle contacts are very important, right? For instance, would you see the same kind of data if you had a dense suspension of hard spheres? Probably not. I mean, have you tried to do that?
Yeah, so I haven't done that, but there are some experiments from Heinrich Jaeger's group. So what they did is they have a well-controlled system of PMMA particles, and those are like colloidal particles around 1 micron in size. So so although the packing, you are right that there might be the jamming transition at like the packing fraction might be different, but they have observed similar phenomena, but at a higher packing fraction. For cornstarch, we see it around, suppose around 50% volume fraction, but they have observed close to 55% or something. But it is the force response is very, very similar.
Okay. And what's also the status of understanding of the formation of these jamming fronts? For instance, you know, do you have clusters that form and that kind of aggregate? I mean, have there been any?
So there have been some ultrasound measurements. So what you can do, you can send sound waves when you have this formation of jammed region. So that sound, the speed of sound, it is sensitive to the local density basically. But what we found is like there is no change in local density inside the jammed region. So we believe it is more like geometrically jammed rather than having a like actually compressed region. That is also supported by the fact that the sound speed in this material, if you go above the sound speed, actually you can locally compress it. But our experiments, our pulling velocity is 2 mm/s to 1 m/s, so which is well below the sound propagation speed in this material. So it is unlikely that it will get compressed at that.
Okay, so let's thank the speaker again.